morning, everybody. Today, I'm going to discuss a few points about the clinical application of fine needle aspiration cytology. I'm sure all of you must have had classes on what fine needle aspiration cytology is and all its advantages, disadvantages, and all that. One thing I'd like to tell you from the outset is that FNAC is, as far as the surgeon is concerned, a very useful tool, not only from the ease with which it can be done, but the time that is saved and also tolerated well by patients. The problem with an FNAC comes actually for the pathologist, because interpreting an FNAC is not as easy as interpreting a fixed slide, permanent section. So with that, I think we will go on to the topic. Yeah. Now, as you all know, there are various ways of getting tissue diagnosis from a solid swelling. You can do an FNAC, which is what we are going to discuss today. We can do a core biopsy, which is also a type of needle biopsy, but you get in an FNAC, all that you get are cells, whereas in a core biopsy you get tissue, that is, you get the architecture. You're able to see the architecture also, which is extremely useful in a lot of situations. So that is one of the we'll come to that later. Then the other way in which you can do biopsies by get tissue diagnosis by doing an excision biopsy or an incision biopsy. If you can't remove the whole swelling, you can probably do an incision biopsy. Out of which, as you can imagine, you know, just an FNAC is just like any other injection actually. So it is that simple. Whereas if you're doing a core biopsy, you need a bigger needle. That is different. That is one point. But more importantly, the tissue that you are sampling must be fairly large in size. Otherwise, you cannot do a core biopsy. Whereas an FNAC, even very small areas, you can do an FNAC. Excision biopsy, sometimes you may require general anesthesia, all sorts of problems. Incision biopsy has almost the same problems as excision biopsy. So coming to the advantages of an FNAC over other types of tissue diagnosis, it is easy to do. Like I said, it is as simple as giving an injection. There is no anesthesia required. You can give local anesthetic if necessary at the most. Other than that, you don't require any anesthesia. Unlike excision biopsy or incision biopsy, which might require general anesthesia, spinal anesthesia, regional anesthesia, and all that. There is no need for any preparation or any other investigations. What I mean by this is that if you're going to do a biopsy on a patient under general anesthesia, require a lot, whole spectrum of investigations, you know, before you can pronounce the patient fit for anesthesia. So that is a problem. Whereas when you do an FNAC, you and the patient are the only two people involved, besides, of course, the pathologist. Whereas the everything else, you require the help of so many other people. And so many other departments and all that. So that is the other advantage. And you do not require any special facility or equipment for doing an FNAC. All that you require is a needle and syringe, a slides, and a microscope. That is all that is, and of course, I keep on saying this, the pathologist is probably the most important component of this gamut of equipment and facilities. Whereas for a core biopsy, you require that special needle to do it, problems like that, then you have to fix the slide, so many other problems. You have to make a permanent slide and all that, stain it and all that. Here also you require staining, FNAC also requires staining, but comparatively simple. The other very great advantage of FNAC compared to the other techniques is that you get the results almost immediately. Within a few minutes probably, you can get a result. So as far as the patient is concerned, you say that you require to take a tissue diagnosis, you say all these options, FNAC immediate, whereas the other thing you will have to wait for at least minimum 4 days before you can get a diagnosis. So that is a very great advantage. Other, like I already told you, FNAC can be done on very small lesions, whereas a core biopsy requires a larger lesion.
And it is cost effective. I told you minimum equipment, minimum personnel required, so it is very cost effective. And other great advantage as far as a patient is concerned is it is very well tolerated, because I told you it's just an injection, so it's very well tolerated. And so as far as a surgeon is concerned, you know, it is one of these, besides imaging, non-invasive imaging, the easiest way of finding out what the tissues. The best example I would like to have, the easiest example that I can think of is, you have a swelling in the region of the submandibular gland. You don't know, I mean, there are features which suggest that it could be a submandibular salivary gland problem, it could be a submandibular lymph node. Sometimes it's very difficult to differentiate this, but an fMRI can easily tell you what it is, whether it's a lymph node or whether it's a salivary gland, and it can tell you the pathology also. So that way it is very useful in certain situations to differentiate the tissue that you are dealing with. Yeah. There are a lot of few disadvantages also. This mainly concerns, I think, the interpretation of the slide, you know, which is very difficult for the pathologist, because all that you're getting here are cells, unlike all the other methods that you use, where you can get the architecture. So not only the cells, but like for example, in a building, you get one single brick, very difficult to say what that building was. But if you have a wall, or if you have two walls, probably you can make out what that building was, you know, it's something like that. So it's very difficult for the pathologist to interpret. Yeah. Then obviously technique, if you don't use the phone. Now there are various techniques that are used, just aspiration, aspiration technique, non-aspiration technique and all that. I won't go into the details, I think this must have already been discussed by the pathologist, so yeah, I won't go into details. The most important thing is you must strike the right area. If you are doing this FNAC, if you don't get the cells from the right area, obviously the interpretation is going to go awry. And as I keep on saying, interpretation is the most important thing here, and for that you require trained personnel. But the advantage of this is that you can use it as a screening procedure. For example, if you have a screening procedure for breast lumps, you can use this FNAC to see, not only for breast lumps, all sorts of lumps, you can use it to see whether it is a malignant or a benign tissue, which you can probably teach a technician to do. You understand, you don't require a trained pathologist, a technician, you can teach them to do it, so it can be used on a mass scale for screening. But it requires extra training. Yeah. The other problem with an FNAC is it may not always be sufficient for certain type of lesions. For example, a lymphoma. With an FNAC, you may not be able to say exactly what it is, because there are so many types, subdivisions of lymphomas, and you want to do IHC staining on that. All this cannot be done on an FNAC. As of now, though it is, I think, coming into work, doing IHCs on FNAC, probably coming to. Yeah, so for a lymphoma, for example, you will require the architecture. So you will require a tissue, you will require some amount of tissue, not just the cells alone. And like I was saying, it is not possible to do immunohistochemistry studies. Grading is not possible. Differentiating between a carcinoma in situ and a malignancy may not, and an invasive carcinoma may not be possible. So there are certain drawbacks to FNAC. But on the whole, as a first line, and not only as a first line, but in most situations, an FNAC is usually sufficient for planning further management. Yeah. Then we can discuss FNAC depending upon the location and where you have the swelling. So we will start with the neck. Then you can discuss it with relation to gastroenterology, pancreas, adrenals, paraaortic, retroperitoneal masses and all that. Yeah. So coming to the neck, obviously I told you lymph nodes, it is very good. It can tell you whether it's a lymphoma, but to find out what type of lymphoma and all that, you might have to take a lymph node excision biopsy of a lymph node, or a true cut biopsy. A large lymph node, probably you can do a core biopsy. Thyroid gland, it can tell you most lesions. Common problem that is encountered with the thyroid gland is when you have what is called a follicular adenoma, which may be follicular neoplasm, which can either be a benign adenoma or it could be a malignant follicular cell carcinoma. this differentiation is not possible doing using an FNAC. The reason is that I told you it contains only cells, and to diagnose a follicular carcinoma, we require to find out whether it is invading the surrounding structures or it's gone through the capsule and all that, for which you require the architecture. For that, FNAC is not sufficient. So there, when you do an FNAC on a thyroid nodule and the report comes as a follicular neoplasm, you probably will have to go in and do a remove the part of the thyroid. You'll have to either do a lobectomy or something like that to get a tissue diagnosis as to whether it is carcinoma or not. That is one drawback with the thyroid. Salivary glands, again, it can tell you most lesions of the salivary glands. So it is very useful. The other problem with the salivary gland is you should not do a core biopsy, they say. The reason is that these cells get seeded along the track of the core biopsy needle, and instead of the salivary gland alone being involved, you can get involvement of the skin also, because you usually go through the skin into the salivary gland. So you get involvement of the skin. So you are spreading the tumor from just the salivary gland into the skin also. So when you do surgery, you have to excise all sorts of problems. So that is why only an FNAC is allowed for a tissue diagnosis in a salivary gland. There are rare exceptions to this, which I won't go into now. Yeah. So that is the thing about salivary gland. Then when you have a cystic lesion in the neck, which is also fairly common, you can have sebaceous cysts, you can have all sorts of cysts, you can have cysts from the thyroid, you can have parenchyma cysts, like that, a lot of cysts that you can get. Again, an FNAC is useful in a cyst which contains a solid component. What do I mean? If it's a pure cyst, that is no solid component, just liquid, 99%, it's almost 100% benign. There is no need for an FNAC to see whether it is benign or malignant. But if a cyst contains a solid element, even in the thyroid, if there is a cyst and it contains a solid element, you must always do a FNAC, guided FNAC, to see whether it is malignant or not. But a pure cyst in the thyroid, 100% benign. So that's about cystic lesion. So that, see, your imaging tells you it's a cyst and there is a solid element. You are in a dilemma as to whether this is malignant or not. So there your FNAC comes in as very handy. Yeah. Then obviously you can use it for other miscellaneous conditions, parathyroid tumors, to find out whether it's a parathyroid and find out whether it's malignancy. Probably an FNAC will help. Parathyroids, lying behind the posterior to the thyroid gland, sometimes very difficult to differentiate between parathyroid and thyroid. So there an FNAC comes in handy. And you have to find out the problem with the parathyroids is especially in an adenoma. You want to know whether it's a functioning adenoma, which particular, there are four of the parathyroids and which is functioning. Difficult to find out even on an FNAC, but it might help. But it will tell you that it's parathyroid tissue, that much is sure. Similarly, dioma, cyst, teratoma, all this can be diagnosed using an FNAC. Yeah. I'm discussing complications here mainly with relation to the neck, but this is common to most situations. Hematoma, hemorrhage, like any invasive procedure, you can have a hematoma or hemorrhage. Infection, again, is possible. In the neck, especially in the thyroid, recurrent allergen nerve injury is possible, but very rare. Nowadays we have guided, that is you can use an ultrasound to guide the tip of your needle to the exact location that you want. So with guidance, chances of injury is very minimal, but I suppose it is possible. Infraction of the lesion, that is you injure the blood vessel to the lesion, not to the whole gland, to the it can get infected. The problem here is later on when you take a biopsy or you do a surgery and remove it, you will not be able to interpret what that lesion was. You will have to rely purely on your initial FNAC finding. I hope you understand this. Once the lesion is infected, the pathologist cannot tell you what it is. You can only say it is infarction. You understand? Whether it's malignant or not may be difficult to say. Needle track seeding of a tumor, which is what I told you in relationship to salivary glands. So you will not. This is a rare possibility. Also, even if, why is it? Why do we say that needle track seeding does not take place with FNAC? The reason is we use a very thin needle, fine needle. So unlikely, but always possible, isn't it? Once you breach the capsule of a tumor, it's always the capsule containing the tumor. It's always possible that you can get seeding. Fatalities after an FNAC, again, almost impossible. The only exception probably would be if it is a vascular tumor, like for example a carotid sheet tumor, you know. If you go and do an FNAC, probably you will end up with a fatality. So very vascular tumors, FNAC not to be done unless, you know, you have guidance, you have imaging to guide you and all that. Yeah, so these are, most of these complications are common to all other locations, hemorrhage, hematoma, infection, all these things are common to infection, all these are common to most other locations. But I discuss this in relationship to the neck, that's all. Yeah. Uses in gastroenterology, I told you, the olden days, gastroenterology used to be a big problem. I'll give you a specific example. Carcinoma of the head of the pancreas, you know. In the olden days, we had no way of getting a tissue diagnosis other than by doing what is called a Whipple surgery, which is a very major surgery. You have to do it. So what we used to do is, we used to rely on imaging, CT scan pictures and all that, and clinical picture of the patient and the tumor, CT scan images, and we used to suspect that it could be, you know, almost, yeah. By depending upon the CT scan image alone, we used to think that this is probably a malignancy, so we go ahead and do a Whipple, understand? And sometimes it turns out to be a benign lesion. You're doing a very major surgery on a unnecessary major surgery for a benign lesion, which is, yeah. And the complications of Whipples, I will not go into, it's a very major surgery, which in the olden days had a mortality rate of about 50%, understand? Nowadays it's not that high. It's very low, comparatively low, but the complication rate is still very high. So what I was trying to get at is, nowadays we have what is called endoscopic guided FNAC, US. So you must have heard of gastroscopy, isn't it, where you pass a tube through the into the stomach, you can see the stomach, you can take biopsies from all that. Yeah. Now you have ultrasound, which can be passed along with the gastroscope, and using a needle, you can take an FNAC from a lesion around the stomach, around the esophagus. When I say around, it must be abutting onto the stomach or abutting onto the esophagus. There must be nothing in between the lesion and the stomach or the esophagus. So paraesophageal lymph nodes, you can take a FNAC. It will tell you whether the lesion is benign or not. If the paraesophageal nodes are involved, your staging of the carcinoma of the esophagus changes dramatically. So the prognosis and the treatment will also change. The example I was giving you about the pancreas, you can use its EUS, you pass it into the stomach, you can take an FNAC from the nodule within the pancreas. And this FNAC will tell you whether this is malignant or not. If it is not malignant, you can probably ignore it and follow that. Whereas if it is malignant, you will go ahead and do the Whipples. It is, it is a tectonic shift, you know, from doing major surgery on a benign lesion to doing surgery when necessary on a malignant lesion. It's very useful. Yeah, paraotic nodes you can do. So all these, all these advantages. So that is about EUS and FNAC. The breast, lesions in the breast, so mostly you can use an FNAC to differentiate between malignant, benign, cysts, various types of cysts, various types of malignancies. I told you the problem is to differentiate between a in situ lesion and a invasive carcinoma. That is sometimes not possible. The other disadvantages in the breast is, I told you, you cannot do IHC to find out whether it is ERPR positive and all that. Similarly, grading is not possible. So besides the primary diagnosis of the primary lesion, the other advantage of FNAC in the breast is when you have done a mastectomy for a patient who has had carcinoma of the breast, and the patient complains of a nodule in the line of the lesion or in the breast, you can do an FNAC to find out whether it's a recurrence or not. Similarly, after the mastectomy, if you get lymph nodes in the axilla, or if you have done a breast conservation surgery and you develop lymph nodes in the axilla, you can do an FNAC to find out whether it is a recurrence of or a metastasis or not. So a recurrence or a metastasis can be easily diagnosed using an FNAC when you have already diagnosed the primary lesion. It can also, supposing you have a carcinoma of the breast and you have lymph nodes in the axilla which you are not sure whether it's malignant or not, even before the primary is treated, there also you can do an FNAC and make sure whether it is malignant or not. There are certain problems with this, it is not always used. We use other techniques like a sentinel probe biopsy to find out whether there is a metastasis in the axilla. We won't go into these controversies, but I was telling you from the beginning itself, a very simple procedure which answers a lot of doubts which you may have, the surgeon, treating surgeon may have, and it is very well tolerated by the patient, so you can use it in most situations. Yeah. Salivary glands, I already told you, I'm sorry, something is wrong with the slide here. Yeah, salivary gland, I told you, it is the investigation of choice for getting tissue diagnosis. You cannot do crew cut. The other option, if you are not doing an FNAC, is you will have to do a superficial parotidectomy. For example, if it's a parotid gland, you will have to do a superficial parotidectomy just to get a tissue diagnosis. You understand? A very major procedure again. But your pathologist can help you out by interpreting your FNAC slides. So that is something wrong with the slide, sorry. So that is the greatest advantage in a salivary gland. Again, in the submandibular salivary gland, I told you, differentiating between submandibular salivary gland and the lymph node, very useful. If there is a tumor in the submandibular salivary gland, again, to get a biopsy, you will have to do a submandibular salivary gland excision, salivary nectomy. But with an FNAC, you can get a diagnosis without going in for this major surgery. See, all surgeries have complications. FNAC also has a few complications, but they are very minor compared to the other complications that you can have with a surgery. Yeah. Then we come to testicular tumors. This is one area where FNAC is still not used. Again, the reason given is you don't want a seeding to take place, you know, tumor seeding to take place. The problem here is, you know, testicular tumor metastasizes to lymph nodes in the parietic region. Whereas, when you do, if you seed these cells into the skin, then besides the tumor being spread into the parietic, it will spread to the inguinal region also, lymph nodes also. So then your dissection, your treatment all becomes very difficult. That is why we do not still use FNAC for testicular tumors. Testicular tumors, you have to remove the tumor testis as such and then send it for biopsy. I mean, if you are in doubt, you know, most imaging and other techniques will tell you whether, and your clinical examination probably will tell you the diagnosis, but if you want a confirmatory diagnosis, the only way is to remove it. You can't do an FNAC on a testicular tumor. Yeah. Yeah, this is a picture. I told you about follicular neoplasms of the thyroid. This is just to show you the difference between an FNAC and this. I'm sure you must have gone through all this when you had your classes in pathology. Yeah. On the left side, you see the FNAC picture of the lesion, that is a neoplasm, follicular neoplasm. Where on the right, you can see that it is breaking through the capsule, and so that is why this particular block of tissue is necessary to diagnose a follicular carcinoma in the thyroid. It's not possible on this, on purely on cytology, as you can see on the left side. So the right side, this particular tissue is necessary to, yeah, this is just to show you that contrast between cytology and architecture. Yeah. Thank you.